The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
This morning, and welcome back to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, your station for fresh news, smart talk all day. It is Monday, the 23rd of October, 2023, and you are on the clock with Erin Greene. On the clock, we have conversations that help us understand and navigate a rapidly changing Bahamas. We've got lots to talk about this morning. It's kind of a what's in the news day. I've got a couple of stories I'd like to draw attention to, but I'm also interested in what you think we should be focused on this morning. So let's get it going. I want to start with this very sad news. Dr. Gomez dies. Former Minister of Health Dr. Perry Gomez, who was at the forefront of the fight against HIV and AIDS in the Bahamas for decades, has died. The Nassau Guardian has confirmed. He was 76. Prime Minister Philip Davis said, "Today our nation mourns the loss of a giant in public health and a true son of Bahamian soil." Dr. Michael Perry Gomez, the Prime Minister, added, "His legacy extends beyond his pioneering work in medicine. As Minister of Health, Dr. Gomez displayed a profound commitment to ensuring that all Bahamians had access to quality health care. His belief that health care is a human right, not a privilege, resonated deeply with me and has continued to shape our government's policies. Today, as we grieve his loss, let us celebrate the life of a man who truly exemplified what it means to serve one's nation. To the family of Dr. Gomez, Anne and I extend our deepest condolences. Know that the legacy of Dr. Perry Gomez is etched into the hearts of our nation and will continue to inspire us for generations to come." We join in that sentiment, in that statement, the Prime Minister. We say condolences to all of his family and friends and loved ones. I have another important notice. I have to say happy birthday. I have to say one good auntie, because this is my last remaining blood relative auntie, right? Oh, I got plenty aunties. And they are all, we are all related by commitment and loyalty. But this auntie, today we celebrate Ona Mitchell Powell Bailey. Mind you, her birthday was yesterday, but she was busy in church, because she's a woman who believes in church and community. In fact, she believes, she, like every other member, she is the church, and you are the church. And the church survives through our commitment to one another. And for that, we celebrate Ona Bailey. I wish I had more time. I wish I could have turned it into Ona Mitchell Powell Bailey Day. And we could talk about cakes and big crab and rum cake and guava duff and all of the beautiful things that used to flow from Mrs. Bailey's kitchen. And we say happy birthday to her and all of her children, all her grandchildren and her great-grandchildren, all her nieces and nephews. We all say happy birthday. We say thank you to the New Covenant Baptist Church community for always supporting and showing the same loyalty and commitment to Miss Bailey as she has shown to the church and to the church family. And Co saying happy birthday, Ona Bailey, and most of all, those of us who were patrons of Suckers National Bank, we miss your service, we miss you daily, and we say happy, happy birthday, Ona Bailey. Good morning. Now, I've got some more good news. I got someone joining me in studio this morning, Mr. C.A. Newry. Good morning, Mr. Newry.
Thank you very much for the invite again to be on your show. Erin, good morning to you.
Good morning. You've been to Food Fest?
I passed through Food Fest. I wish I had time to experience it, to enjoy it, to engulf it, to immerse in it.
Yeah.
I did not. I wish I had gone on Saturday, even though Saturday tends to have a large number of crowds. I think the crowd is a part of it. But when I passed through, it was late in the evening. Right, I passed through by myself. I didn't have time to purchase any food. I just went in to soak in the atmosphere to see if this particular spot works. Because, you know, I do commentary.
Yeah, yeah.
I do commentary. So I wanted to soak in the environment, yeah. Right? So that's why I passed through. I walked around. I see how the people interacted. And all of that was just for commentary. But I wished I had time to say, hey, I'm here to enjoy myself. And I did not have time for that.
Yeah, I was there also working, right? So I didn't have an opportunity to hang out and enjoy the festival in that way, but I did a lionfish demonstration.
Tell me about that. Where did you get lionfish from?
So where I typically get lionfish from and where most of lionfish stocks come in is at Montague Ramp, mm-hmm. right? And there are a number of fishermen out there you can put in an order. So they don't necessarily catch them regularly, like they go out to catch snappers, mm-hmm. but they take orders. And you got to put in an order because usually whatever they bring in is already on order.
Claimed already.
Or the extras get snatched up, right, by mm-hmm. those who put in the order.
And when you say demonstration, what do you mean? You demonstrating how to catch it or you demonstrating how to hold it?
I was demonstrating how to handle it and how to trim it properly. So the demonstration is for the home cook, the person who ordered the little restaurant chef, the person who's going to be dressing the fish, right, mm-hmm. preparing it for cooking. Because lionfish is venomous, and it has these beautiful spikes on it that open up into fans when they're underwater.
And when you say venomous, is venomous? So
a barracuda can be poisonous. The barracuda will have poison in it. And if you ingest the barracuda, you will ingest the poison, right? So we ingest poisons. We take them into our mouths, right? Like into our bodies. But venom, the animal, they inject the venom into you, right? So a barracuda, if it has poison in it and you eat it, you're going to get poison. And your body may deal with the poison differently, right? It may impact your body differently from another person's body, but you definitely consume the poison.
My next question is, how do you cook your lionfish? Do you curry that, curry lionfish?
Well, look, yeah, let's
fish tacos.
Let's talk about it. You can replace most of your traditional Bahamian fish with lionfish. So most of your Bahamian meals with fish, you could replace. You do stew fish, lionfish is perfect for stew.
You think so? Because I always say that a fish need to be heavy bodied, not flaky, for a good stew fish. You know, you steam it down, whatever it is.
You fry it down and then you steam it down and then so you tomato it up.
I wouldn't have, never thought that lionfish would have been good for a stew fish.
Well, it's interesting, right? So typically you would use the lionfish to replace a grouper in a boiled fish, mm-hmm. right? A hogfish fillet, maybe, mm-hmm. a grouper fillet. Perfect, like you say, light and flaky. But the wing bits, we call the shoulders are meaty. And although the meat is very tender, it still has a nice amount of body to it. So we find that lionfish is actually a great replacement for your traditional fish. If you are a stickler for grouper, New Year's morning, grouper, Christmas time, but you didn't catch and freeze any Nassau grouper before the season closes December 1st, mm-hmm. then you could replace your grouper with lionfish.
Okay.
Yeah, man. Okay. It's a nice, big, meaty fish, right? So while a snapper tends to be sort of lean, the fillet can be sort of thin, lionfish is just a solid fish. I say that lionfish is fish for man.
But let's talk more about the International Food and Wine and Cultural Fest. I hope I pronounced that right, because the name keep on getting longer and longer.
Yeah, so they did have a name change a couple of years ago, I think, to the International Cultural Wine and Food Fest. It's the festival we typically know as Food Fest. Mm-hmm. Like a few minutes.
Okay.
What I was most interested in is the transition from botanical gardens to the fort, and whether the organizing committee could recreate the ambiance of botanical gardens at the fort And if they could inculcate like the fort structure into the festival space itself, right? So those were two points of interest to me. I also do got to take a moment to say good morning and thank you to Nikita and her team at the entryway to go into the festival. I know Nikita from summer camp days. You know when people call you by your other name, when you, your children name? I know her from summer camp days. I want to say thank you to those guys who accommodated us while we were waiting to get into the festival. Producer, I see you got a call. Let's see, we got a call here. Let's go to this call. Good morning, caller.
Good morning. Good morning. It's Greene.
Good morning. Did you get turn down your radio for me?
Yes, we just put it on mute. Thank you very much. I wanted to say a special shout out to both of you all and to the Bahama Islands and all our visitors and everything. A pleasant good week, a new week starting again. Hope everybody be safe and be happy. Very productive and whatever. But I'd like to say a shout out to a special friend of mine who I've known over 20 years. Miss Laureate Cartwright spent most of her years in customs. And over the weekend, she celebrated her 83rd birthday on Saturday, October 21st.
Yes.
And I did a special tribute to her this week. I got a car license for her. We got a beautiful birthday cake. We got everybody together. And we went down to Aquafire. And we had a night out. So I just want to say shout out to Miss Laureate Cartwright from Sparky and family and friends. And from the group, The Masters Fest. Happy birthday, darling, and be pray for you to see many more. Have a good one, Miss Cartwright.
Absolutely. Now, Sparky, I got some questions for you. You say Miss Cartwright is 83, and you went to go license a car for her. Miss Cartwright, what you be doing on the road at 83? And do you take Sparky with you when you go gallivanting? And do you all have a chaperone? And do you require a chaperone? See, Ben, Mr. Newry, that raises a whole bunch of questions for me, you know, because you can't limit people's freedom of movement unreasonably, right? You can't just say, oh, you're old, you can't drive yourself no more. You can't say that. Mm-hmm. But I do question whether older Bahamians ride safely with this new driving culture.
No. Nor handicapped people. We need to take a serious analysis of our streets in terms of how can the pedestrian traffic in general.
Yeah, without a doubt. I can get back to that.
Yeah,
let's go back to the food fest just for a second. Right, so I was doing a lionfish demonstration. I got a text here that says, what does it taste like? Like I said, it's reminiscent of, when I say reminiscent, it tastes like a nice grouper fillet or hogfish fillet. Mm-hmm. But you can also treat it like a snapper. Mm-hmm. You could steak it up mm-hmm. and fry it like snapper. You could fry it whole like snapper. The only thing with the lionfish is that you're going to take the head off. You're not going to cook the head. You could use the head to make fish stock for further recipes and mm-hmm. applications. Or you could bake the head in the baker until it's dry and turn it into bone meal and make fertilizer for the garden. Or you can get a pot, a bucket with a lid, and you can put it in the bucket with water and begin to collect your fish scraps in there and create what they call fish tea, which is a great fertilizer. Sorry, I missed you. Caller. Someone said, I had a great time at the festival yesterday. My children enjoyed it. However, the space to me seemed a bit too tight. However, it was historical because that was my first time inside the fort.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
And we need more traffic in the fort. And like the have not experienced our various tourism aspects. So mm-hmm. it's good that we can emerge both.
Absolutely.
But then we need to appreciate why the food fest is there. At this present time, the botanical garden is going through some renovations.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be...
I think aren't they doing Heroes Garden?
Heroes Garden there.
Yeah.
And so that's going to take a bit of time, getting the statues to be erected, built, placed there, right?
Yeah.
And we need to know exactly how that space will be after that transformation of the Botanical Garden. So, of course, the people at the International Food Fest is looking for a home. So they have to try out different venues and find the best venues. And best thing we could do as Bahamians is perhaps recommend a venue.
Yeah.
But Botanical Garden may no longer be available.
For festivals.
For festivals. And we got to acknowledge that. And then either accept the change or suggest a better one instead of just complaining for complaining's sake.
Absolutely. Right? But I want to talk about why I was there. In a second, we're going to go to this caller, producer. Let's take this call. And again, good morning, caller.
Hey, Miss Greene, calling you back for them questions there. Mrs. Cartwright drives a brand new Mercedes her son bought for her.
Don't talk to business.
My granddaughter flew all the way from Cardi yesterday.
Yeah.
And my daughter came in for a golf tournament of what I heard that the Bahamians came third in the golf tournament of Paradise Island.
Okay.
And my daughter always came, also came over for Miss Cartwright's birthday. And she does drive the car. And she drives better than me because I only drive at 30 miles an hour. But I always tell Miss Cartwright, she got a little automatic heavy foot.
I got you.
She drives very well, but she doesn't drive at night anymore because, you know, I have a problem at night too. Seeing with on lights coming on to me, I normally have to stop on the side of the road. But she has a son that lives here. The rest of her children live between Florida, North Carolina, and Canada. They all grew up in the Bahamas, born in the Bahamas, went to school here, went off to school. She sent three children off to university and all doing well. All got their own businesses in the United States. They
good
came
stuff.
Back here after graduating, but they couldn't find a job because they were too overqualified in the Bahamas.
Yeah.
So they went back to the United States. You ever send your children off to school to get an education, and when you come back, people say they ain't gonna hire you because you're overqualified? Have a good day. Welcome to the Bahamas.
Thank you, Sparky. I'm also just very glad that both you and Ms. Cartwright had chaperones on this wonderful, wonderful birthday weekend. A quick text say, what if we don't consume the lionfish? If we don't consume the lionfish, if we don't add the lionfish to our palate, to our diet, like we do grouper and snapper and hogfish and jacks and margaret fish, right, then we're going to have a problem because the lionfish... We run the risk of the lionfish consuming and obliterating all of our juvenile lobster, conch, shrimp, and fish stocks, right? That's the risk with the lionfish. It is if you just leave, if you ignore it, it will continue working. You know, unlike many of the policies of the Bahamas government, you can't ignore the lionfish. This is a problem you cannot ignore. If we don't manage the populations, we run the risk of decimating our lobster and crawfish and conch and juvenile fish stocks and shrimp stocks. Yeah, we have to focus on the lionfish. So, Mr. Newry, I have something to share, though. So after I did the lionfish demonstration on behalf of my little company, Seasonal Sunshine Bahamas, and we want to say thank you to the organizing committee for giving us that opportunity, one of the patrons put some money in my hand. They were impressed by my stale, dry jokes.
Nice.
And I want to give away some of that money. In fact, I think I want to give away all the money.
You can give me some of that money.
I'm thinking about it.
Please.
I'm thinking about it. You have a children?
I have children.
Because I do either like a children's organization, an organization that focuses on children or the elderly or animals or sick or disabled people.
I have a children's charity called the Children of Cecil Newry Fund. You can contribute to that.
Yeah, I need to see the offices. I need to see your paperwork.
I'm the one of the officers. I can speak on behalf of that charity.
No, I think that I would like to speak to the other officer.
The children are patrons of that. So they can speak and they'll accept the money.
So right now I got two names in mind. One is the Ranfurly Home for Children, and the other is to donate to a cause being led by Dr. Ebby Jackson. And I'm not sure if there's a name for her campaign, but Dr. Ebby Jackson is running marathons. She's a breast cancer survivor, and she's running marathons, global, worldwide, international marathons, to raise money for local organizations that support breast cancer and support cancer patients and cancer survivors. And she is gearing up to run the Arctic Marathon that was recently run by one of our leading roadmasters, one of our leading runners. But let me take a moment and go to this call. Good morning, caller.
morning, Erin Greene.
Good morning. How you doing?
I'm fine. Good morning, Yuri.
Blessings to you.
I want to give my condolences for the family of the late Minister of Health.
Yes.
Gomez.
Yes.
Yeah, he was a good Minister of Health. And he helped establish the AIDS Association, eh?
Tremendous work at the forefront of the fight against HIV and AIDS.
Yeah, he really lead that area, and a lot of improvement now in that area. That's wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
So they do that. By-election is in the air, eh?
We'll be getting to that. We'll get into that in a minute.
Yeah, as we get into that, I probably want to get into it more when they call it,
okay.
When they call it date and time.
Yeah, that's one of the things we're waiting to see what the date is.
But you have, I don't know if you have the papers.
I do have the papers.
Bishop run it? That's PRBA.
Okay, say that again, Pumpkin Eater.
Bishop.
We'll get into that.
Whatever.
We're going to get into it. Have you read the papers yet, Pumpkin Eater?
No, that was my accident. I just wake up watching a game last night.
Okay, Pumpkin Eater. Well, let me get into it and then...
Sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, I'll talk later.
Thank you. So anyway, yeah. Thank you, Pumpkin Eater. We're going to get into that. I just wanted to throw that out on the table. I had these two causes that popped into my mind immediately, the Ranfurly Home for Children and the Dr. Abby Jackson Marathon Campaign for Breast Cancer Survivors. And you can make donations to the Dr. Abby Jackson. Let me repeat that. Dr. Abby Jackson's campaign at Palmdale Vision, among other places. So Mr. Newry, other than the C.A. Newry Children's Fund, what about the Fox Hill Public Library? You know the little library boxes? Are they still, you still have one of them in Fox Hill?
I actually have books in my car now to drop off to some little libraries. Of course, you know, that's one of my things that I do. I go around and put books in various little libraries around town. So if you have books, especially children books or books for reading leisure, you can always give it to call me and I'll come and collect it. And then I'll drive around town and make sure that the little libraries are stocked for people who are interested in reading books.
Where's the one in Fox Hill?
Actually, I go to my own neighborhood mostly, right?
Okay.
Which is Hay Street or by Hay Street Park.
Okay.
Scroogey place.
Yeah.
And I tend to stock that every 2 weeks.
All right.
2 weeks.
Yeah. Nice.
And then I every so often I go to the beaches. Like there is one on Goodman's Beach. There's one on Bay Street too. I cannot picture the one that in the Fox Hill, what the place name? The Fox Hill place where they have the meetings.
The community center.
Community center. Fox Hill Community. That's where the little book thing is, library is
okay.
In Fox Hill.
All right, cool.
But that's stocked. That's hardly ever empty. That's stocked.
I got you.
And that's manned by the Fox Hill police station there too. That's their, they man that.
All right, so I'm asking people to send in suggestions for where I should donate the money. It's just $100. I mean, it's not huge, but $100 can be huge in an organization's work or in an individual's life, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I want to pay it forward, definitely. I just had a great time doing the demonstration.
Mm-hmm.
We hadn't done it in a long time. I'm just grateful for that opportunity, you know, so I can pay it forward.
Yeah, but we have time. Today, tomorrow, people call in and give suggestions. And
yeah.
We'll make sure the money...
And then forward. By Thursday, I'll announce who I'm giving it to.
Yeah, you can always give it to the Newry Children Fund.
Fun. Don't forget the fun part. Otherwise, it's a totally different scheme.
Yeah, that's like, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
One quick story before we go. Man dies after getting trapped under Mack truck. This is the 20th of October, 2023. We say condolences to the family and loved ones of that motorist. This happened at the junction of Carmichael and Golden Isle Roads. The gentleman was believed to be in his mid-20s. And I wanted to make this note. That article is the 20th of October, 23, which is a Friday. This accident happened after midnight on Thursday. That was the fourth traffic-related death for that week and the 45th traffic fatality traffic-related death for the year. And then the sad news this morning that yesterday, Sunday the 22nd at 4 p.m., a motorcyclist was killed in a collision in Nassau Village, making that the fifth traffic fatality in the matter of a week and the 46th traffic fatality for the year. I don't really want to dwell on such morbid news, but I think it's important for us to look reality in the face and say that there's something terribly wrong on our roads. And it's not the condition of the roads. That is terribly wrong, we get it. But there's something even worse than that. And it's our attitudes when we get behind the wheel of these vehicles, right? A vehicle is also a weapon if used incorrectly. And it is our attitude behind the wheel that turns the vehicle into a weapon. I'm going to say this one more time. Dear Minister of Works, Clay Sweeten, I'm going to request that you gather up all the dual carriageways in New Providence and take them to the Family Islands and install them there. For these people in New Providence have no need for a dual carriageway. They do not respect the roadway and other drivers and think that the dual carriageway provides a secondary lane so people could pass you while you're using your cell phone and driving. I will stick to this point because I've lost far too many friends and loved ones to traffic fatalities. We must do better, Bahamas, and we start by acknowledging that we know it's against the law to drive while using our cell phone. And we know that it's indecent and a sin to be on a highway, JFK, making 15 miles an hour because you want to use your cell phone safely. Just please stop. Our own behavior. I got a text that says, good morning, and please pay it to the Newry Children Fund.
There you go.
I mean, it's a real legitimate text. I had to
read
it.
They understand. Bless
another text said,
temporary texter.
We can't drive. He said, that's what it is. We can't drive. And I agree with you. We don't understand how things work. Anyway, Mr. Newry, it's by-election time. Are you ready?
Yeah. Sorry, but I'm...
No, I mean, are you ready for by-election time?
No, because nobody has reached out to me to say, Niri, a by-election is coming. Come this way. So I am concerned.
Has a date been announced yet?
A date has not been announced. However, 60 days after the seat has been vacant,
right.
That means that upon the death of...
The Honorable Obadiah,
I don't remember when he
transitioned. So he passed on the 25th.
So by
September.
So 2 months after that. Let's add 60 days. Give a calculator there.
Right, yeah. So I think the 60 days from the 25th of September would be the 24th of November, which is a Sunday, if I'm not mistaken.
So November 24th. So
it's a deadline.
Before Thanksgiving. Let's say, instead of being specific, we'll say before Thanksgiving, the election will be held.
Yeah, and I doubt they will hold it on a Sunday.
No.
Right? So it has to be... Before the 24th.
Yes.
I think I'm concerned.
What are you concerned about?
We should have a date by...
We know it's before Thanksgiving.
There should be a date.
For who?
What do you mean for who? For the whole country?
It's not... It has nothing to do with the whole country.
Pause.
It has something to do with West Grand Bahama.
What do you mean
Bahama?
It has nothing to do with the whole country?
You're all Nassau... This is not Nassau-centric. This is a Family Island affair. Why you want to be involved in Family Island business?
Let me tell you why.
They are having a by-election.
Let me tell you why.
Not a national general election.
Let me tell you why this by-election is everybody's business, Mr. Newry. First of all, as citizens of this country, we have an obligation to fellow citizens, in this particular instance, the residents within the constituency bounded by the political descriptor, West Grand Bahama and Bimini. We, the wider population, have an obligation to them to lend our ears, our eyes, and our critical thought to ensure that they are able to enjoy their rights, and have access to free and fair elections. Mm-hmm. We, the wider public, have a duty to them. Secondarily, party governance is a model for national governance, right? This is an opportunity for us, the wider public, the voting public, those who have influence, to observe and assess how party governance operates. And it gives us insight or highlights the capacity of that party to govern at the national level. What you do inside your party is likely what you're going to do at the national level. If you ignore the tenets of your constitution at the party level, I say it's likely that you can also or will probably ignore or thwart constitutional principles at the national level. That's why it's everybody's business.
All that to conclude, leave Grand Bahama people alone, man. You're an asshole. People always dictate to us.
We haven't dictated
it
anything.
Sounds so.
All I'm saying we owe them a duty.
You
owe observe.
Let us family worry about ourselves.
How you get in the family islands, Mr. Newey? Fox Hill ain't no family island.
You ever drive Fox Hill to see the same conditions in Fox Hill in the Acklands? We's a family island. We far out. You're an asshole. People always want to dictate to family island people. But I understand. I understand what you're intending to say. But, right, the date hasn't been announced, right? We now have all of the candidates, or majority of the candidates, announced that they are running, right? We now have the person for the FNM. We have the person for the PLP. Read all this into the record so people can consider it for those people who didn't see the news.
Yeah.
We also have the COI. We have two independent people are running, right? So it's going to be for an interesting election, right? We have the issue about Shane Gibson running, and all of that needs to be discussed. And it seems like we need more time, so I'll allow us to continue this conversation also.
We get 20 minutes.
No, I talk about it on my side. We'll continue this conversation
delve into it. Absolutely. Guys, we go into a break, and when we get back from the break, we're going to jump into the by-election. We're looking at articles. FNM ratifies candidate. Smith ratified as PLP candidate. Gibson requests secret ballot at NGC. We'll be right back. You're on the clock with Erin Greene.
Wait, why you look so mashed up?
I did, wait.
Hard day. What happened? The breakfast lady ran out of tuna and gritsy.
We need to start joking with everything, you know. This serious, boy. This real serious, boy.
Wait, what's serious? Tell me.
All right, well, today, boss gave us boy a big, big contract. And nobody else get a chance and nobody say nothing.
Boy, you know that ain't right. You know government contracts ain't supposed to go that way.
Yeah, but nobody say nothing. Boss man just tell people to sign the papers. Then he send me to meet his boy downtown and collect this envelope.
You need to tell somebody. You need to become a whistleblower.
You know I's a real man, but I never blow no whistle. I be drunk all my life in Junkano.
No way. A whistleblower is someone who tells people what they see when they see something wrong happening at work.
But I ain't no whistleblower, and I ain't no snitch. I still wait there, you know.
Boy, ain't nobody gonna know it's you. All you gotta do is call Crime Stoppers, or you could text them from inside the Crack Crime Bahamas app. They don't ask about you, and your call goes straight through to Miami, so nobody know who you is. And if you text, your message get mixed up like Kong Salad.
Call 328-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
It's the Battle of the Bronx, sponsored by Canoe, and you decide who wins. October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, so strap on your gloves and join the fight. It's easy. Just download the Canoe app, vote for Mammogram Access Program, the Grand Bahama Cancer Society, or Sister Sister, or go to the Battle of the Bra event page on Facebook and vote. Each vote is just $5. Polls October 26th. Vote as many times as you want. You can even vote for all three. It's the Battle of the Bra. Winner will be announced on Friday, October 27th at the Pink Lotus Affair at Blair House.
This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove them all right song.
Thank you.
and welcome back to On the Clock with Erin Greene. It's by-election time, Mr. Newry. Let's get into it. First article, FNM ratifies candidate Bishop Ricardo Grant, a native of 8 Mile Rock, Grand Bahama, was last night confirmed as the Free National Movement's FNM candidate for the West Grand Bahama and Bimini by-election, which is expected to take place in a matter of weeks.
You want me to give commentary on that, or you just tell me?
Hey, well, let me read the next one, and then we can give commentary.
I'll analyze both individually.
Smith ratified as PLP candidate. Chief Passport Officer Kingsley Smith has been selected as the Progressive Liberal Party's PLP candidate in Bimini by-election. Former Minister of Housing and National Insurance Shane Gibson, who declared himself to be the people's choice, said he had no comment when asked to respond to the news. So you stick a pin there before I get into that third article. Mr. Newry, for me, what is more interesting than why Shane Gibson didn't get the seat is, what does general orders say about public servants' participation in frontline politics and political affiliation?
One can request a leave of absence.
But when do you request it? Do you request it when you put in your application to campaign? Do you have to wait until the leave of absence is granted before you could put in the application to be a candidate?
That's semantics.
No, it's not semantics.
And leave of absence can be immediately. I need to leave now.
But
No. If I am sick, I need to leave now.
Right, but that's when I write the letter. Does it not... When does it apply? When you've been granted the leave of absence?
Now, and I understand the question, right? And we don't know what happened here. But let's say the leave of absence, just for conversation, was done a week prior. Is it okay? Yes. Since we do not know
when... It was approved, not submitted. When the request was submitted, but when it was approved.
Now... This is, and see, we doing assumptions, and this is the ill part of it. Now, let's assume, somebody do an assumption, it was submitted and it was approved. Is there an issue? It was submitted and approved. Is there an issue?
Well,
let's assume that it was submitted and approved. Is there an issue?
I don't know. Because I haven't read it. I can't find, here's my thing.
Go ahead.
I can't find the general orders online.
Remember, this issue came about during the Renwood Wells debacles, several of them, but I remember him specifically, being a government employee, mm-hmm. whether several people went also underneath this, right? Whether a civil servant, public servant, is able to run. And it was concluded, yes, they are able to run because it's a constitutional issue, right? And you just submit your leave of absence. Right? Mm-hmm. And we assume that the leave of absence went in time and it got approved, and then you were able to run.
So first things first, why are you assuming or are they assuming?
No. We're assuming because you now question whether the leave of absence was submitted in time. And I said, let's assume that it was. So we don't have to debate that. We just don't know. Just assume that it was. And if it wasn't, right? That's an internal administration thing. It's nothing to do with us.
What do you mean
right?
It has nothing to do with us?
Because the person in charge of the the civil service is the only one who can object and say this was done improperly. And then I assume that they will go to the government. Guess who government is it? They'll go to the government and say this was done improperly. Can the minister, so you see how it goes back, can the minister sign off on it? See, why put in all this hullabaloo when the conclusion still would be the same?
Because, first of all, it has to be questioned.
Why?
Because this is not a plantation. No, because this is not a plantation. Okay. First of all, we don't just presume. See, the way that the law works is that we presume that all law is good law until it's shown to be bad law.
So you are suspecting that it wasn't done in time.
Well, here's my point. Post a John Pinder era, all of these things have to be questioned, and they have to be shown to be done. They can't just be done. They must be shown to be done.
And I can appreciate that. I appreciate that. The showing to be done is just as important, right?
As the doing.
And we know that even with Mr. Pinder, he too was a civil servant who was on leave. He was educational leave of absence.
Just, oh, no. With Mr. Pinder, we have statements. I'll have to go pull them up. But we have statements from Pinder indicating that, yes, I was working.
But remember, he had to come. One of the issues is he had to come back to his job in order to get his pension because he was on leave. That was his issue. Say, hey, remember he said, hey, I need to worry about my pension.
But let's pause. He was campaigning for a nomination.
Yes, but remember
within the party while he was acting as a director.
But remember, he was not announced as a candidate.
No, pause. He was campaigning for a nomination, and that was made public.
Yeah.
And then B, he got the nomination and then said he gonna have to resign.
Yes.
Aren't you supposed to resign first?
Oh, that's semantics, man.
It's not semantics, Mr. Newry.
Don't bother me at all.
That's like somebody called the chair of the Public Disclosures Committee telling me that, yeah, they did it. I think they did it. I'm sure they did it. I don't know. The Prime Minister have the information to be done, not just done. And the reason why I think it's important to stick a pin is because this has become political culture. I must just trust you that you're doing the right thing, even though it's obvious that you're not doing the right thing because you are not disclosing. That's a part of the right thing as well. Which leads me to the second article, Gibson requests secret ballot at NGC.
Mm-hmm.
Shane Gibson, the former Christie era cabinet minister who's seeking to make a political comeback, yesterday wrote the Progressive Liberal Party's secretary general requesting a secret ballot at the National General Council for the selection of a candidate to run on the party's ticket in the West Grand Bahama and Bimini by-election, which must take place soon. Gibson wrote, I write to request that at tomorrow's meeting of the NGC, the selection of the candidate be conducted in accordance with Article 10.4.7 of the party's constitution, which requires the NGC to, quote, be allowed to vote by secret ballot on the approval of candidates. Close quotes. In so doing, the internal democracy of the PLP will be preserved and perceived by all to be fair and transparent. To do otherwise invites an ill view of our internal processes. Producer, let me tell you why I think this is important. Because in the article itself, it says, Chief Passport Officer Kingsley Smith has been selected as the PLP candidate for the seat. For the election.
Mm-hmm.
He's a passport officer. He's a chief passport officer, which means he works within the ministry that's being led by the chairman of the party that selected him as a candidate.
I have no problem with this. No problem at all. I'm not sure what you're bringing up. I just don't understand what you're trying to get at.
I'm going to go to this caller and maybe I could understand you some more. Good morning, caller.
Hey, Ms. Greene, how are you?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Mr. Newry.
Mm-hmm, blessings.
Good. Ms. Greene, you're on to something, you know. You hear what you read just now?
Yes, sir.
Kingsley Smith, passport.
Officer.
Officer works under the chairman of the PLB.
Yep, in his capacity as Minister of Foreign Affairs.
Thank you. Yes, let me say this. On Friday night, The room that the voting took place in had standing room only.
Mm-hmm.
Standing. They had more people, to me, I believe they had more people standing up than sitting down.
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
sir.
Okay? The trip to that was, then the leader, Mr. Davis, stood up and said, all who for Kingsley Smith stand up. Okay?
Okay.
You don't have more than half of the room standing up.
Okay.
So how are you going to pick out from there who's who with who?
Okay.
Okay, now hear me now.
Yes, sir.
Hear me now. Okay. They say, all right. They said, all who for Shane Gibson stand up. Now, these same people who stand up against these men, they still standing up for Shane Gibson.
Mm-hmm.
So shouldn't they be spoiled ballots?
How would you? How can you take an accurate count?
They signed up for the daughter.
I got you.
And Shane Gibson, I'm a supporter of Shane Gibson.
Clearly.
Shane Gibson was in Treat Valley. If they had had a close, and then another thing about it, they had a lot of people that didn't stand up for nobody.
Mm-hmm.
So them people who didn't stand up for nobody, it shows to me that they was with Shane Gibson. But what? If they had stand up, their little road work contract, their little disc contract was going to get pulled in. Now, if they had voted in secret ballot, that would have been a different.
I got you. Yeah.
Now let me say something else.
Mm-hmm.
Shane Gibson and the Smith man wants to run in Vincennes and Bimini.
Mm-hmm.
Why they didn't take that to Vincennes and Bimini and let the people in Vincennes and Bimini decide who they wanted?
Yeah, but I think they said
the old come would have come out just like the same way with the same Smith man and Obi Witzker. Them people up there don't want him. That's why they had to bring that down here. But they got to see, they got a road awakening, they can see it. And let me say this in closing.
Mm-hmm.
If you see Shane Gibson want to play the devil advocate, I'd say, guess what? Hell with it. I run an independent.
Boy, that's one of
Shane
my questions on the table today.
When
but Shane mightn't win.
Yeah.
I guarantee you the Smith man ain't going to win.
Doesn't matter.
Cut a deal with and the F&M win hands down. Lincoln being ain't gonna win.
It doesn't matter.
Lincoln being getting 100 vote, he 50 vote, he 60 vote, he happy. He just going up there to party and have a good time. But if Shane Gibson decides that he's gonna run as an independent,
mm-hmm.
is there's no win I see.
Okay.
I'm a PLB.
All right.
Thank you for
now, if
calling.
Shane were to run as an independent, I wouldn't support him. But I can't stop him from doing what he want to do.
Yes, sir.
I'm a PLB.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay.
All right.
I find there's a win for no reason, you know, right? It's an organization,
mm-hmm.
right? It's either you're a PLP or you're not. If the Honorable Shane Gibson decide not to be a PLP, not to be a team player, to go against the team, right?
You think the PLP will take the honorable from him and say, you win this under our party, you can't use this honorable as an independent?
One must declare that the machinery of the PLP must declare war. Because
I don't like that war talk in politics, man.
But the idea is, if you say you're no longer a part of the team and you are prepared to go against the team mm-hmm. and destroy the team, so we only have one thing leave.
Well, look,
the machinery has to take place.
That's important commentary. Let's go to this caller, and then we can get back to that. Because I want to ask, what about an independent Gibson in 2026? Good morning, caller.
You go where?
Screen.
Good morning.
That's a very interesting thought. And what you asked, Mr. Nuri, good morning, Mr. Nuri, to go into YouTube when we're done and type in conflict of interest. With the question Miss Greene asked you.
I think I watched the movie.
Oh, whatever. So, what if Mr. Gibson, right,
mm-hmm.
decides to go independent? What if he decides to cross the floor? Because remember the much more most honorable Von Miller crossed the floor?
I have not confirmed uh-huh. for myself. I heard Shane already been an F&M or tried to be an F&M.
Hold on. Now, you said independent. There's three scenarios. I'm going to run them by you. He could go independent.
Imaginary talk, though.
He could go independent.
Imaginary talk.
He could cross the floor to the F&M, mm-hmm. or he could go COI. He has three options.
Or the Constitutional Party. So let's pretend.
That's right.
Or let's go.
So he's got four options.
I can form a party today, and he could come join me.
You'd have one seat in the House, CA.
Let's even pretend and say that all of Grand Bahama becomes one seat,
Graham.
And not four seats anymore.
Well,
let's pretend all of Northern Bahamas turn into one seat, and there's only two seats in the Bahamas. Let's pretend.
The country, Erin. I'm trying to have a conversation sensibly with you. Let's pretend we get distracted with this and Israel goes to war and we have $20 gasoline, CA. What will you do for fuel and electricity? Not digress. Let's stick to the subject. The subject is Mr. Gibson is wanted. They like him. But who the people... Remember Jesus and who was that guy? Barabbas?
Yeah.
Give the people who they want. And so what happened was, if you don't, then you could have a problem. But I'm saying Mr. Gibson... He holds all the cards today. Now, what if he did go to the FNM, and what if he did go to the COI? COI, if he did win under COI, they'd have one seat. If he went independent, he'd have a seat. And if he went with the FNM, they'd have one more. Doesn't mean a hill of beans to Mr. Davis, I don't think, because he's still the prime minister with the majority of the seats. So we might be distracted with this instead of looking at that $6 U.S. gasoline we're buying and the inflation and hyperinflation that's coming, Ms. Greene. But your conflict of interest, we got it. We got what you were saying, Ms. Greene.
Thank
you. We got what you were saying. Have a good one.
Absolutely.
Even, I don't like dealing with what ifs, Erin.
Hold on. If we get into that right now, even Israel can't do anything with Benjamin Netanyahu. It's a problem. I worry about $6 gas, $20 gas. The world, Israel can't do nothing with Benjamin Netanyahu. That's a problem. Let's get back to this now, because can Shane Gibson, is Shane Gibson's political career viable without the PLP?
No.
Do you think he overplayed his hand?
He overplayed his hand. Let me give example. Since we're playing what if Shane Gibson decides to challenge Pierre Glover role?
Yeah.
I think the people in Golden Isles say, man, Pierre doing a good job, man. You need to go find someplace else to go. See? But why do what if? What if Shane, see, I can do with us all day. What if Shane Gibson said, I'm going to run in Cat Island? Why entertain these
preposterous stories? I tell you why. Because we were already stunned when Shane Gibson said, yes, I am in my gal. Yes, I am talking to people. Yes, I am doing things. People were stunned then. Then to see him shoot up to West Grand Bahama by-election.
And this is where we debate on whether his political clout is meaningful. People were concerned when a parliamentarian, who we thought retired, challenge a sitting MP who's doing a good job, an adequate job in Ackland, Mayor Kyle.
Hold on, pause. Say what?
Challenge him, say, I take in the seat.
What do you mean by adequate?
See, that's semantics in terms of if you believe you're doing a good job and if they believe. People in Ackland say he's doing a good job. Some other people say he's not doing a good job.
I remember the 100 days with no light, you know, like the 100 day war. Like they had,
that's Andrus.
No, that's Ackland.
But
you forget.
All of Nassau have the
North
same issues.
Don't forget.
But my thing is, how do we allow a former parliamentarian to challenge a sitting MP who plans to run again?
Within the same party structure.
Within the same party
stick
structure.
A pin.
Then move all the way to let's
take
chaos.
Let's take this call very quickly. Caller, we got 30 seconds for you, and then we got to pick up on the other side of the news. Good morning.
Good morning, Ms. Grant.
Good morning.
Sorry for calling back. Please forgive me.
No problem.
But Mr. Nuri, it doesn't seem like... I know he likes to stir up trouble, but listen to me. Shane Gibson is the person now that is holding all the cards.
No,
like the
not
person the caller said. Gibson can make the PLP in this by-election or break the PLP in this by-election.
Any government
that lose a by-election, people start to look at them cross-eyed.
I disagree.
You have all the marbles to believe it. You have the treasury to play with. You have all your big donors to play with. You lose a by-election sitting as a sitting government, 9 out of 10 chances, you lose the general election. I don't care how long it takes to come.
Thank you. Thank you very much, caller.
Okay?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And don't mind Mr. Nuri. He is offering a great counter debate, right?
Erin.
Yeah.
If PLPs, because we know where the FNM is going to vote.
Yeah.
The FNM is going
to vote
FNM. If PLPs think that it's in their best interest to vote against their party because one member or a person who they thought should get the nomination didn't get it, then it is what they get. They get what they get.
Look here,
they get what they get.
Just before we...
But don't make no
before
sense.
Before we go to the break and I have to step down and you become the prime minister, right? You think the PLP is going to pull an FNM 2021?
What you mean?
Well, FNMs, you are right, FNMs refused to vote PLP, but 45,000 didn't show up.
Culturally.
We can go to the break.
PLPs vote no matter what.
Okay, good stuff. Let's go to the break. When we get back from the break, we can pick it up right there.
Mm-hmm.
Culturally, PLPs vote no matter what. You've been on the clock with Erin Greene. On the next side of the break, I'm going to read these texts, and we're going to pick up the conversation. Mr. Nuri is the PM now. Stay tuned. Guardian Radio AM. Guardian Radio AM with C.A. Nuri coming up next.
Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.